Hello everyone, welcome to DNA Education. I am Himanshi and in this session we will be discussing about the topic evolution and speciation. Now, जैसे कि हम सभी सुनते हैं दैट वी ऑलवेज से दैट सम पीपल हैव इवॉल्व्ड ओवर टाइम, तो इसका मतलब ये होता है कि बहुत सारे चेंजेस एक पर्सन में विद टाइम आते हैं, जिसके बाद उन चेंजेस के साथ साथ वो पर्सन धीरे धीरे चेंज होके एक स्टेट से दूसरे स्टेट में जाता है, तो इस प्रोसीजर को हम कहते हैं इवोल्यूशन. सो इन टर्म्स ऑफ साइंस वी डिफाइन इवोल्यूशन एज एक्यूमुलेशन ऑफ चेंजेस ओवर टाइम विच अल्टीमेटली लीड्स टू द प्रोडक्शन ऑफ अ न्यू इंडिविजुअल. सो दिस इज इवोल्यूशन. नाउ अकॉर्डिंग टू एनसीईआरटी कुछ मेथड्स हैं जिनसे इवोल्यूशन हो सकता है, तो ये थ्री कंडीशंस हैं एनसीईआरटी की. लेट अस लुक एट देम वन बाय वन. फर्स्ट इज नेचुरल सिलेक्शन. कंसिडर करते हैं कि एक पॉपुलेशन है जो कि बीटल्स की पॉपुलेशन है, और जो रेड डॉट्स हैं दे रिप्रेजेंट रेड बीटल्स एंड द ब्लैक डॉट रिप्रेजेंट्स द ग्रीन बीटल्स. सो बीटल्स यूजुअली ग्रासेस में रहते हैं, तो जो ग्रीन बीटल्स हैं दे विल बी क्वाइट कैमोफ्लेज्ड इन द ग्रीन ग्रासेस एंड दे वोंट बी दैट मच विजिबल. बट जबकि जो रेड बीटल्स हैं वो ज़्यादा हाईलाइट होंगी और सामने से दिखेंगे ग्रास पे. नाउ सपोज क्रोज आती हैं एंड दे फीड ऑन बीटल्स, सो क्रोज विल बी एबल टू सी रेड बीटल्स मोर क्लियरली दैन द ग्रीन बीटल्स. तो क्रोज धीरे धीरे रेड बीटल्स को खाएंगे और जो ग्रीन बीटल्स हैं उनकी पॉपुलेशन धीरे धीरे बढ़ेगी एंड द पॉपुलेशन ऑफ द रेड बीटल्स विल ग्रेजुअली डिक्रीज. एट सम पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम जब क्रोज बहुत सारी आ गई हैं and they have eaten all the red beetles in a particular area, तो उस particular area से सारी red beetles remove हो जाएंगी और सिर्फ green beetles ही रह जाएंगी. So यहाँ पर हम clearly देख सकते हैं कि जो पहले population पूरी red beetles की थी, finally वो due to the accumulation of changes वो green beetles की population हो गई है. And this procedure is called natural selection, or we can say this is evolution by natural selection. मतलब कि यहाँ पर नेचर, दैट मीन्स एक ये नेचुरल फिनोमेना है कि ग्रीन बीटल्स विल बी कैमोफ्लेज्ड इन द ग्रास एंड वोंट बी विजिबल टू द क्रोज, एंड दिस प्रोसेस इज डन नेचुरली एंड हेंस इट इज़ कॉल्ड इवोल्यूशन बाय नेचुरल सिलेक्शन. नाउ मूविंग ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज जेनेटिक ड्रिफ्ट. दिस इज अनदर मेथड बाय विच इवोल्यूशन कैन अकर ओवर टाइम. Consider this situation, this is a population of all red beetles. Now suppose कोई भी chemical change या किसी भी mutation की वजह से किसी एक particular organism में कुछ change हुआ और gradually it converted into a green beetle. Now even in this situation majority of the population is of red beetles, but there is just one or maybe two individuals who are different. अब red beetles will reproduce in their own way, but the green beetle will produce their own types and more green beetles will be produced. Suppose by any chance or by any phenomenon, as per NCERT example it states, suppose a foot of elephant occurs on the area and the elephant's foot covers all the red beetles, then because of this all the red beetles will die, leaving behind only the green beetles. और अब जब ये green beetles reproduce करेंगे तो the next population will be of all green beetles. So in this case again we see how red beetles converted into green beetles due to accumulation of changes over time. So this is evolution by genetic drift. Genetic drift means a change in the frequency of an allele of a gene in a population. For example, there is a gene for the body color that can be red or green. Initially that was red, and the frequency of the green allele for the population is 1 out of 16, but it shifted drastically and it became then 6 out of 16 and finally 100% or 1 by 1. So this is called genetic drift because the genetic frequency of green body allele has changed or drifted across the evolution process. This is genetic drift. The third condition that is explained in NCERT is this. Suppose this is a population of red beetles in normal conditions. Now due to maybe famine or koi dusre reason ki wajah se jahan pe nutrition's ki deficiency ho jaye, sufficient food available na ho beetles ke liye, to wo उनका साइज डिक्रीज हो जाएगा, बॉडी श्रिंक हो जाएगी, दे विल बिकम फीबल एंड दे विल डिक्रीज इन साइज. बट when normal conditions will restore, they will get sufficient food and nutrition back. They grow into full-fledged organisms. So in this case, you see that the process is reversible. That means original population is restored in the end. Whereas in the above two cases, the population changed altogether, and by any means, this population can now not be shifted back to the original population. So these two processes indicate evolution, but this process does not indicate evolution because it is reversible and it is an acquired trait and not judged by the genetic or constitution of the organism. These are the three cases. Now let's come to Charles Darwin. Charles Darwin introduced the concept of speciation. First of all, what speciation is? Speciation is the process of formation of a species. As we know that changes are continuously happening in organisms and during reproductions. Because of the accumulation of those changes, evolution occurs. Now, suppose changes are being accumulated over generations, so a time will come jab first population jo hai aur final population ke beech mein bahut zyada difference aa jayega. Itne zyada changes accumulate ho jayenge that the first population will seem to be altogether different than the final population, and this will result in the formation of two different species. As we know, species is a group of organisms that is capable of interbreeding, that is the individuals can reproduce among themselves. But itne changes accumulate hone ke baad wo entirely different organisms ban jayenge such that they won't be able to reproduce with each other any longer. In this state, we say that two new species are formed, and the whole process is called speciation. Now, what Charles Darwin did is that he went on a voyage. The name of his ship was HMS Beagle. Through ship, he went from England to South America, and he roamed about and observed the organisms there. He mainly focused some finches. He observed some finches and he found that at different places, the same finches were having a few modifications in their beak. For example, agar kisi ke paas fruits eating environment available hai, to beaks are modified so that it is easy for them to eat fruits. Agar insects pe wo feed kar rahi hain, to beaks are modified into a different way so that they can easily eat the insects. So in this way, finches were the same, but at different places they showed different evolutions and changes according to their adaptations. So through this, Darwin said that speciation can occur through various means. Let us study how these different methods occur. First is the sympatric method of speciation. During sympatric method, what happens? Suppose ये एक स्पीशीज है एंड ड्यू टू सम चेंज सम म्यूटेशन एंड इमिग्रेशन दैट मीन्स सम डिफरेंट जेनेटिकली डिफरेंट ऑर्गेनिज्म हैज माइग्रेटेड इनटू अ पॉपुलेशन अ न्यू जीन और अ न्यू अलील ऑफ अ जीन डेवलप्स. So what will happen is that these individuals will start reproducing and form more individuals of their kind, which will be different from the original population. Slowly and gradually, this will become a different species and this will become a different species, and ultimately we will get two different species. So this is called sympatric speciation, which occurs due to a change within a population, as we see that this new variation arises within the population. Another method is allopatric speciation. Suppose ki ek species thi aur koi barrier, ek physical ya geographical barrier us species ke beech mein aa gaya. Jaise suppose ye pure organisms hai to beech mein koi river aa gayi ya koi mountain aa gaya, aur because of some natural calamity koi crack aa gaya jiski wajah se ye is side ke organisms are not able to meet the organisms on this side. Now suppose kuch changes ab is population mein aaye and these variations started occurring in this population. They will reproduce among themselves, but these changes won't be able to travel to this area because of the physical or geographical barrier, and slowly and gradually over time they will ultimately lead to the formation of two different species. In allopatric speciation, as we see that there is an external barrier which leads to the formation of two different species, jabki sympatric mein internal element hota hai aur allopatric mein ye external element hai. The next is parapatric speciation. In parapatric speciation, simply say this is a population, and let us assume that some organisms of this population started to live on a periphery, or they sort of made their new area among themselves, and now randomly these organisms do not mix with these organisms and these do not mix there. So suppose changes occur in this population, and because individuals are not traveling to this area, the changes will be confined to this region only. और इसी तरीके से यहाँ के changes अपने आप में accumulate होते जाएंगे, and slowly and gradually this will become an entirely different species, and we will again get two different species in the end. So this is parapatric speciation. So we have studied the three basic methods of speciation. Now let's come to another topic which describes how we can trace the ancestry of individuals. For example, अभी हमने देखा कि कैसे एक species से दो नई species बन गई. अब ये जो दो नई species हैं, they can be altogether different from their parent species. So by looking at organisms, we have to judge कि कैसे वो organisms अलग अलग different organisms से evolve होकर आए हैं. इस पूरे relationship को trace करने के process को, उनकी study को कहते हैं phylogeny. So study of phylogeny can be done in two ways, by the study of homologous organs and by the study of analogous organs. So let us study what these are. Homologous organs indicate divergent evolution. Divergent means spreading in different directions. So basically homologous organs हमें ये बताते हैं कि कैसे एक particular organism जब अलग अलग areas में जाता है, तो वहाँ के environment से affect होके वो अलग अलग तरीके से evolve कर जाता है. तो you see that single organism is radiating into different directions and evolving in different ways. Hence this is called divergent evolution. And a good example of this is limbs of frog and man. Limbs include forelimbs and hind limbs, that is our hands and legs. The basic structure of our forelimb includes humerus. There is a humerus bone, then there is radius and ulna, and there are phalanges. And if you see at the limbs of frog, they also have a roughly similar structure. So we see that these organisms are having basic structure similar, but the function of the limbs is altogether different. For example, we use our legs for walking, whereas frogs use them for hopping and jumping. So here we see that in homologous organs, their structure are different, but functions, their structure is same, but the functions are different. So this indicates divergent or homologous evolution. Next is the analogous organs. Analogous organs always indicate convergent evolution. That means it might be possible that different organisms living in different areas, they are having a similar function, and their basic body design might be different. This indicates that these organisms might at some point of time had a common ancestor. That means कहीं ना कहीं past में उनके common ancestry रही होगी, जहाँ से अलग अलग जगह से evolve होकर वो आए हैं. तो यहाँ पर हम basically different regions से एक common ancestry की तरफ जा रहे हैं. That's why it is called as convergent evolution. इसका एक best example है wings of bat and bird. As we know that bats and birds both use their wings for flying, but the wings of birds are made up of feathers, whereas the wings of bat are actually skin folds. So we see that in analogous structures, the functions are same, but the basic body design or structure are different. So this is about homologous and analogous organs. There is one more way by which we can trace the ancestry of an organism or a species, that is fossils. Fossils are actually dead remains of plants or animals which are preserved over thousands of years. Suppose कि कोई एनिमल या प्लांट किसी एक पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम पर एग्जिस्ट करता था एंड इट डाइड, तो जो बॉडी के रिमेन्स होते हैं वो सॉइल में, रॉक्स में या दूसरे मटेरियल्स में, आइस में इवन, वो हमेशा के लिए प्रिजर्व हो जाते हैं, और वहाँ पर बहुत सारी चीज़ें छूट जाती हैं. फॉर एग्जाम्पल जो ऑर्गेनिक मैटर है बॉडी का, जैसे कि मसल्स एंड ऑल, वो सब डिस्ट्रॉय हो जाते हैं, लेकिन स्केलेटन डिस्ट्रॉय नहीं होता, वो वहीं पर ही प्रिजर्व हो जाता है. जैसे अगर हम प्लांट्स की बात करें, तो सॉइल में या रॉक्स में उनकी लीव्स के इम्प्रेशंस रह जाते हैं, तो उन इम्प्रेशंस को स्टडी करके हम बता सकते हैं कि उस लीफ का या उस प्लांट का ये स्ट्रक्चर रहा होगा या उस एनिमल के ये ऑर्गन्स रहे होंगे. दिस इज कॉल्ड फॉसिल्स. तो स्टडी ऑफ फॉसिल्स इज ऑल्सो अ वे ऑफ ट्रेसिंग एंसेस्ट्री ऑफ ऑर्गेनिजम्स. नाउ हाउ फॉसिल्स आर स्टडीड, देर आर टू वेज, डिगिंग एंड कार्बन डेटिंग. वट इज डिगिंग? फॉर एग्जाम्पल, कोई ऑर्गेनिज्म 1000 years पहले एग्जिस्ट करता था, तो वो जब द एनिमल वुड डाई, इट्स रिमेन्स विल बी सबमर्ज इन द सॉइल और इन वॉटर, एंड इट विल बी प्रेजेंट इन द डीपर लेयर्स ऑफ सॉइल, एंड देन new generations will come up on it, and when they will die, they will all form in, they will all be embedded in different layers of soil. So when we start digging the soil from top to bottom, we will be getting different layers of fossils. The layer on the top will indicate the recent most organism, and the layer which is found in the deeper layers will indicate the older organisms. So in this way we can trace that which organism existed earlier and which are the recent organisms. Another is carbon dating. In the body of all organisms is made up of carbon. Carbon is the basic element which makes up the body of plants as well as animals. So there are some radioactive carbon elements which gives radiations. So basically, by analyzing the amount of radioactivity in a particular body or a fossil, we can determine how old that fossil is. For example, अगर कोई fossil 1000 years पुराना है, तो उसमें से 1000 years से radiation आ रही है, तो उसका जो decomposition है वो ज़्यादा हुआ होगा. इसी तरीके से अगर suppose कोई organism की का fossil सिर्फ 500 years पुराना है, तो 500 years से उसमें radiations आ रही हैं, तो वो भी decompose हुआ है, but 1000 years पुराने ऑर्गेनिज्म से कम डिकम्पोज होगा. तो ये रेडियो एक्टिव एलिमेंट्स की रेशियो को जज करके हम बता सकते हैं कि विच ऑर्गेनिज्म अकर्ड अर्लियर एंड विच आर द रीसेंट ऑर्गेनिजम्स. सो इन दिस वे फॉसिल्स आर स्टडीड. अनदर इम्पॉर्टेंट पॉइंट ड्यूरिंग द स्टडी ऑफ इवोल्यूशन इज दैट इवोल्यूशन शुड नॉट बी इक्वेटेड विद प्रोग्रेस. हम कह रहे हैं कि ऑर्गेनिजम्स इवॉल्व कर रहे हैं, तो इसका मतलब ये नहीं है कि ओल्डर ऑर्गेनिजम्स वर poor and the recent organisms are much better than the their ancestors. This is not the case. It just states that the body of the organisms has become more and more complex over time. But this doesn't mean that we in any way are much better or are progressed than our ancestors. Now, moving on to the next topic, human evolution. Now we have seen how evolution occurs, how speciation occurs, the different methods of evolution and speciation. So now let us understand how we as humans have evolved over time. The oldest fossils of humans are known to be found in Africa. So it is said that all human races were initially found in Africa, and human evolution is traced back at that place, and then individuals maybe traveled to America or Europe or South America or Australia, and in this way they occupied the entire globe. So basically we find that humans have basic evolutionary point in Africa, just because the oldest or the deepest layer of the fossil of humans that is found in Africa. This is a list of various species of humans that is known to exist. Australopithecus, these were the earliest organisms, and they gradually evolved into Homo habilis, then into Homo erectus, then into Homo neanderthalensis, and finally into Homo sapiens, which are the modern humans, that is us. Now, various changes have occurred in these organisms, like their brain capacities and it has increased. Australopithecus has less brain capacity, and gradually over species the brain capacity increased. The forelimbs were usually longer than the hind limbs, like in apes. In the older organisms, gradually what happened, that organisms used to be tilted, their backbone was tilted, gradually they became erect, hence the name Homo erectus. Because earlier humans used to walk bowed, but gradually they became erect and forelimbs were reduced, and finally we get our modern species, that is Homo sapiens. So this is all about human evolution, and for more details you can refer to our book of DNA Education Key Points Science Class 10th. The concept of human evolution is explained very well in the book. Rest. This is all for today's session. Hope you understand. For more details, you can log into www.dnaeducation.com. Thank you.